Hello, and welcome to RV Talk Radio. Join us here at each show where we visit RV products and services and RV tips, RV living, and RV lifestyles. So relax, grab a cup of coffee. Let's talk about RVs. Hello, and welcome to another edition of RV Talk Radio. This is episode 40, so I guess that's a milestone for us. So, woohoo! Anyway, so I just got to tell you right off the bat, I figured out how to make a cat go crazy. So we finally got around to setting up we got permission. So we went to the office to make sure it was okay. And we got permission to put a hummingbird feeder in front of the window. So we got the little suction cups, and we got this really great little hummingbird feeder. So, of course, since I got that up, the cat is sitting on the back of the chair, looking at this hummingbird feeder, not really realizing what it is. But I swear, it wasn't 10 minutes after I put that thing up, a hummingbird showed up, and I thought my cat was going to have a heart attack. He was like, "That's the biggest bug I've ever seen." Anyway, so now I can't move the cat from the back of the chair. She's like, "Come on, bring on one of them big bugs again." So, if you want to give your cat some entertainment, put a hummingbird feeder outside your window and see what happens. So we're excited. We're hoping to get some hummingbirds, and then we're going to actually set up some up-close cameras to see if we can capture one and using 60 frames per minute so we can really slow it down and so you can see the the wings go slow. It's really cool. So that's I just got done installing that and started the show, and a hummingbird showed up. I couldn't believe it. So I guess it doesn't take much to entertain us. So on with the show. Well, yesterday, Sherry and I were supposed to move to our new location in Arizona, and we were going to go kind of up north. But to make things more complicated is, you know, Sherry just has a job down here that she's picked up and she'll be doing for quite a while. So we're going to be kind of stagnant for a while. And that's okay. We got tons of things Arizona's got a lot to show. And we got to go and tell. So we're going to be doing a lot of Arizona driving around. Of course, we're getting in the warmer weather. We're doing this all backwards because everybody's leaving and we're just showing up. So what I wanted to tell you about was, so we made reservations at a place that we knew about, and it was okay. And we like it. I mean, it's all right. But we discovered this one place over in Fort McDowell that we came across and stayed for a week and fell in love with it. It's a gorgeous park, and I didn't even know it existed, but I mean, we did some videos on it already. Beautiful pool, nice facilities, nice and roomy, nice, really, really friendly people, lots of security, wildlife, probably more than you want to see. Anyway, so we're really happy here. So then we actually packed up the rig. We actually took the rig about 31 miles to this new location, and we got there early, so it was on a Sunday. And it was, I don't know, it was kind of sad. We weren't really happy. We're kind of sitting around waiting for the people to come to the office. And the bad part is we did put a deposit down, but the place that we're at, before we left, we actually got the monthly rates and found out they're about $250-$300 a month cheaper anyway. So in the parking lot there, we made the executive decision and called them back and says, "Hey, do you have room for monthlies?" And she said, "Sure, this is the perfect time to do it." Of course, everybody's leaving. So we literally made reservations in their parking lot at the other RV park and literally turned around and went back. So when we got back, in order to get the long reservations, we actually had to move one space over. And so by the end of the day, we're going, "You know what? That was the longest drive to one space over that I've ever had." And even our neighbors are going, "You're back?" It's like, yep. So we kind of listened to our hearts, had a gut feeling. Sherry likes the commute. It's a very simple commute for her to do her new job. And the other one would have been harder. If you know Arizona at all, she would have had to do some commuting on I-17, and it can get kind of nasty. And the way she goes now is quite easy, and it's actually a very nice drive for her. And so by measuring it all out, it was worth the giving up $250 deposit, which is dumb, but things happen, and we know that. But in the long run, we'll make it up because our rent's actually more affordable here, and we're closer to our daughter and grandkids. So it was kind of dumb, but kind of funny, and at the same time has a good story or good ending to it. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Well, if you've been watching our videos, you probably might have noticed over the weekend we posted a video, and it was actually out of sequence, that we saw our first encounter of a real rattlesnake. And, nope, we didn't see it in a zoo, didn't see it in an aquarium. It was a real thing. And how we came across this was we were driving some back roads in Fort McDowell and doing photography, and I'm driving along, and I see this thing in the road and avoid running it over because I'm thinking it's kind of like a stick or something. And I realize I just ran over, but didn't run over, but went between a rattlesnake. I'm not out to kill them. They have purpose in the world. They terrify me, but I would never kill one intentionally. And I went by, and Sherry goes, "Really?" And I said, yeah, that was definitely a rattlesnake." So we stop. There's nobody on this road. It's a back road. So we turn around, come around, and just pretty much park in the middle of the road. And there it was, just sitting there, kind of taking its time, kind of a little bit shocked because a big old one-ton truck just drove over it. Not on it, but over it. So it was probably going, what just happened? So anyway, I'm pulling out the G40 Canon camera, and I'm out there just middle of the road, nobody coming, and I'm filming this thing. It was awesome, but definitely got the wheelies. And then Sherry's like, I can't see. So I had to kind of maneuver the truck. So I'm doing about a 5-point turn in the middle of this little road. And so Sherry could get pictures of it with her still camera. So anyway, if people are wondering if you saw the video that we did that shows a rattlesnake, that's how we got it. It was like really cool. So I'm one of those ones that if I see a snake, spider, or a scorpion first without being surprised, I'm pretty cool. I mean, it's like, but if I don't see one of those, it sees me before I see it, I would be screaming like a little girl. And, I don't like those critters. So it was really exciting. And you know, it's funny down here. It's kind of like Central Oregon. When we lived in Central Oregon, when we first moved down there, we bought 5 acres, a little mini ranch. And we're just like telling people right off the bat, oh yeah, we got a 5-acre place. And, you know, and around there, they kind of go, what? That's 5 acres is nothing. Most people had 20, 30, 40 acres. So they weren't impressed at all. So down here, you know, I went to go get a haircut the other day. And I'm telling guys, hey, I saw my first rattlesnake. And it's like, yeah, everybody's seen one of those. So it was like, no big news. Except, you know, they'll have much better stories than I have. And so it was kind of depressing because I'm all excited to see this rattlesnake. And nobody else around here goes, yeah, we see them all the time. It's just a fact of life. So I hope I get that complacent because to me, they still kind of, in a sense, rattle me. So that was pretty exciting for us. The neat thing that's going on right now is all the cactuses, it's springtime, and so they're blooming. So I know probably people are going, geez, not more flowers in your videos, but people, they don't last long. So whenever we can get a picture or a gorgeous picture of these cactus flowers, they are just beautiful. And so we're going to try to capture them where we can because they're not going to last. So sorry if you're seeing a lot of flowers, but they're awesome. You just don't, you know, normally I'm around the desert. It's, you're not seeing the flowers. It's just a cactus. But right now, it's awesome. And also, I'm hoping to get a lot more wildlife. We are seeing a lot of roadrunners here, so I'm really trying my hardest to be ready to take a picture of a roadrunner. I'm just, they're a beautiful bird. And then, according to the people that say they've stayed here, we're on the edge of this park, which is right on the edge of no man's land. And supposedly we're supposed to be able to see some of those wild boars, so, or pigs or whatever they call them. They have a proper name. I'll figure it out. And hopefully in a couple of months I'll have all the terminology down. Like, I'm still trying to learn the names of the cactuses, the critters I'm seeing. Like the rattlesnake, it was a diamondback, so we saw that. Finally got the name of that. You'll probably be seeing a lot of springy pictures coming out of us, because we just know this stuff is kind of rare and it's only a certain period of time, and especially the cactuses. We're going to go to a cactus arboretum type place here in a week or so that we can get, where they have some rare cactuses that are blooming this time of year. So we're going to try to get some photos of that. So bear with us with the photos, but if you enjoy photography and you enjoy flowers and rare occasions, the flowers are very special. And if we could get a little more of the wildlife, I hope you enjoy it. They're just supposed to be videos to feel good. And so that's what we're all about. So, on with more information. All right, now it's time for me to remind you of our social stuff. So first thing, did you know that RV Talk Radio has a newsletter? Yep. So if you get the opportunity, go to rvtalkradio.com. Off on the right-hand side, you'll see where you can add your email for our newsletter. It only goes out when we update the site. And you can unsubscribe at any time. It's all automated, so it's no people behind it. And your information is kept private. We do not sell leads to anybody and stuff. It's all just kept for the newsletter. And it works really good. We're really happy with it. We've had it for years. And basically, whenever we post a new show, you'll get an email in a couple of days saying that there's a new show up if you want to go see it. And we also want to remind you to please send comments. And we love your questions. We're going to start focusing on RV questions that we're starting to get coming in. We're going to actually have Sherry on the show and answer a couple questions and go from there. We're also going to try to do some videos of question and answers to be a little more personal and to answer your curiosity questions of how Sherry and I function living in an RV and being pretty normal folks. Nothing exceptional about us. It's a married couple getting closer to the golden years, but not quite there. And we just love to answer your questions, and it also allows us, gives us new ideas, new things to talk about. Also, don't forget, we also have Facebook. We have our own group. RV Talk Radio has its own Facebook group. When you go there, you have to ask to join. We ask that everything stays RV related. If it doesn't, or something pops up, shoot us a note, let us know. If you see something that doesn't belong there, we will remove that person. We also have, RV Travel Buddy has its own Facebook too. We'd love to have you there. And a new site called Daydream Explorer is a new site that we have. Feel free to go on there and get at least like it. Get ready. We're going to start posting to it here pretty soon. It's designed to be a little bit beyond the RV relationship, but we have some interest in going over the border a little bit. Not sure where yet. We're also really getting a kick out of people that are boating. Got our interest, but that's not a route we're going to go anymore. We used to do that. But we want to be able to go beyond the borders of RVing. And that's what Daydream Explorer is all about. So if you want to send me a personal email directly, just go to rob@rvtalkradio.com and shoot me a note if you have questions or statements or suggestions, feedback. We love that stuff. As long as it's constructive feedback, we try to respond. So we also have, did you know that we have our own social network? Yep. It's called rvsocialnetwork.com. And it functions just like Facebook in a sense, but it's totally RV related. It's free to join. Your information is kept private. We do not share your information. You only share what you want to share. And you can put pictures up and you can put videos on and all kinds of stuff. And it has a little chat feature. It's a pretty neat little platform. So if you want to join it, it's absolutely free. It's rvsocialnetwork.com. Anyway, so I got my little information out there. Please send us your questions. Send us your things you'd like us to talk about. We really, really like that. So anyway, I'm moving on. Alrighty, well, we're back, and this is going to be something a little different for everybody. Guess who's on the show with me? Sherry. Say hi, Sher.
Hello.
Yep. And this module, we want to talk about some questions we got in. And so I thought it'd be nice to just have Sherry and I both on the show, and we'll try to address them. Now, some of these questions seem applicable to people that are really full-time RVers, and we are kind of doing a combination of full-timing, extended, and right now we're going to be static. We didn't get rid of all of our stuff, so we have it in storage, right? Mm-hmm. And so anyway, here's one of the first questions, and this comes from, let's see if I can find his name, a gentleman named Steve in Philadelphia. And he gave us a set of questions that are actually awesome. So we thought maybe we'd try to answer a couple. So the first one was, what things from your conventional life did you keep and get rid of when you started full-time RVing? What did you put in storage?
That is a question that everybody has to ask. You know, what is important to them. For us, the very first time we went full-timing, we'd been married for 26 years at the time, and it took us about 4 months to really go through our stuff and sort things out and try to narrow things down. Our goal was to, anything that we wanted to keep, we wanted to have in a 10 by 10 storage unit. So we had...
That was a very stuffed 10 by 10.
It was, but it was, we did it. And the only things that we really kept were personal mementos, photo albums.
Records.
Stuff from our children. We did keep an antique table.
Yep.
A small dining room dinette table that I just was fairly new and I just love it. And we did keep our bedroom set. Yeah.
So what we did on this time, the second time now we're full-timing, we figure we're older. There'll be a time that maybe RVing's not going to be what we can do anymore. But we didn't want to rebuy all of our stuff, so we kept our couches and beds and a lot more furniture than we did the first time. So and televisions and stuff like that. So in the case of... if we decide to settle down again and get an apartment or something like that, we don't have to rebuy all that stuff.
Right.
So I think I would say in the second go around, we probably saved a lot more and kept a lot more things this time than we did the first time we full-timed.
That is correct. We had also had decided the first time around that it was time for a change anyway.
Yeah.
So that if we did settle down at some point, that we were going to want to replace what we had anyway, because it was stuff that we had with the kids.
They were pretty trashed.
So the second time around, we were actually had stuff that was much newer, and it's stuff that we wanted to hold on to. Every person is going to be different, depending on what their needs are, if they think they're going to stay full-timing for a long time or if it's going to be a short term.
So that should answer that pretty good. The next question you had in here, and this one's for us as we're not really big in cooking, but the question's a great question. Cooking on the road, what accommodations have you made as a result of having an RV kitchen, a fridge, stove, etc. Any big changes in your usual diet? And I can say I think we've been eating a lot better. I don't know why.
It's easier. Because we're at the RV so much more and stuff, it's easier just to, you know, open the fridge and cook something.
Mm-hmm.
As far as accommodations, I would say one of the biggest accommodations we've had to make is some of our cooking utensils, pots and pans, especially for the oven. A standard size, big size cookie sheet doesn't necessarily fit in the oven very well.
Yeah, we have been buying a lot of miniature things.
Yeah, so I've had to reduce the size of some cake pans, some cookie sheets, some of just my oven cookware. As far as cooking on the road, I can pretty much do anything that I did before. The only exception would be I may not have as many accessories, such as
choppers and
mixers and blenders and rotisseries and crock pots, because of the storage. So I still can do everything I want to do. I just have to maybe do it a little more of the old-fashioned way.
Yeah, the one thing you did do to your oven, though, we did add a
pizza stone.
Yep.
To the oven, and the purpose of that is to help distribute the heat, because in these ovens, you know, the heating element is kind of right down the middle, so you tend to get a little hot spots.
Yeah.
So by putting a pizza stone in there, it helps distribute the heat, and I get a more even cooking.
Yeah, and the one we put in there is a 12 by 12 by 1. Is that right?
Yeah, it's a 12 by 12 by 1, which the 1 inch being 1 inch thick, it's very heavy. And because it is so thick, it does take a lot of time to heat the oven. But I've also heard that people who've gone with some of the thinner ones have had problems with their pizza stone breaking.
Or cracking, yeah.
And I have not had that problem with the 1 inch, but it is heavy and it does take a lot longer to heat the oven.
I think another thing that you and I finally got over is we don't look at it. We had to quit looking at the RV as a camping RV because we're living it full time. So we finally did something that was amazing, is we actually got rid of, we had kind of like camping silverware, and we finally just gathered it all up, put it in a bag and put it away in case we want to go camping. But we bought good utensils.
Yeah. So cookware is basically the same, our dinner plates, but we did get normal silverware, which makes a big difference.
Well, we also make sure that our plates and are, what's that material that they're made of, so you can drop them.
Oh, I got the Corel.
Yeah, so durable stuff, but getting out of that mindset that the RV is not a camping RV anymore, so we don't have like a, well, we do have a camp coffee pot, but that's only if we just don't have power. But I mean, it's like, it's furnished like a home, and so is the cooking stuff.
Right. The one other thing is the refrigerator is not as big as a standard refrigerator.
Yeah.
So because of that, we do have to go to the store a little bit more frequently, and we do have to be aware of what we buy and how much space we have available, because you are a little bit limited on space.
Yeah, and so for those of you who might have seen an older video, we also have an extra refrigerator. We have a little, what is it, 4 cubic feet? 4 cubic foot refrigerator, a little guy.
Yeah.
In the back of our RV, and we put mostly liquids in there. So we can freeze stuff in a little freezer part of it, but that's not worth it. Maybe ice.
No, we go through a lot of liquid, so it's mostly our water and stuff.
Yeah. All right. All right. So I'm going to move on to another question. By the way, we do realize that the sound has a little buzz in it, and we're using a separate mic for Sherry, and it's putting off a little bit of static. So we apologize for that. But we're just tickled pink that Sherry's on the show. So our next question, and we have kind of a strong opinion about this, is what factors should you consider deciding whether it's worthwhile to put a washer and dryer in the RV? And then the question is, if we did, would we do a single combo washer, a combo one unit type thing, which takes up less space, but are they any good? And so a couple of times whenever we get RVs, we did have one in our motorhome, our 40-foot Fleetwood. And so now is the time to hear Sherry's interpretation of whether we should have a washer and dryer. And?
So in 2006, we had a motorhome that did have a combined washer-dryer unit. And it's really nice for the convenience to be able to do that. But personally, I did not like it because my clothes came out wrinkled, even if you dried them, and I just did not like the wrinkles.
They were, and it was a very noticeable, I remember.
So I have not checked into them since that 2006 time frame, so I don't know if they've gotten better or not, but I was unimpressed with the combo washer and dryer unit by itself, and I felt it was just as easy to walk down to the laundry room, and I could get all my laundry done in basically an hour and a half and be done with it and not have to spend all day long doing little tiny mini batches from the sizes that they have that go into these units.
So when we were in Camping World, do you remember how much a washer dryer combo costs?
I don't remember.
It seems to me it was close to $1,000.
Yeah, it's just something that never interested me because of my disappointment from the past.
So then the reason I mention that is like, okay, so if you were to use the washer and dryers that are at the different RV parks, of course, that would be different if you're a stealth camper and stuff like that. If you're doing a lot of boondocking, I could see where the washer dryer would make sense because there's no facilities.
Right.
But if you do have facilities by, or you can stop at a laundromat, it'd take a long time before you spend $1,000 on washing clothes and drying clothes using those facilities as opposed to buying a unit for your rig. And then being disappointed with the end result. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah. Alrighty, so I'm going to move on to the next question from Steve. Was this Steve? Yeah, Steve from Philadelphia. All right, so Steve, by the way, thank you very much for the questions. It was a great excuse to bring my wife on the show, and that's really rare. So the next thing is, this is funny for sure, not because we're so spontaneous, but mapping out your RV travel year. What are the priorities, and do you have any particular process or tools that we use? You want to try that one first?
I'll let you start on this one.
Well, we'll generally get an idea of where we want to go. Sometimes it'll take us a few days because maybe Sherry will want to go west, and maybe I'll want to go east, and then we kind of mull on it for a while, and then we kind of come up with a plan. And then we also found that the weather has actually dictated which way we go, especially when we're in the Northwest. We're fighting the last part of the winter, and so we're having a hard time trying to figure out how to get out of Central Oregon. So I would say we're a little more spontaneous.
I agree with that. So for us, it's really just getting a general idea of what we want to do. And then we actually start pulling up our Google Maps and start looking at locations and actually if we want to go south or if we want to go east, well, what is out there available to see? And from there, then we start looking at what type of camping passes or discount passes we have to see what facilities are in those generalized areas.
Yeah, like up north, we consider a lot more things that worked around Thousand Trails. Mm-hmm. But as we got down south, there's less and less Thousand Trails as far as Arizona is concerned, and that became less of a factor. So basically trying to save money on Thousand Trails was not really in our mapping, you might say, as we got down south, correct?
Correct. And then the other thing that we tried to make sure that we did is we didn't want to tie ourselves down to any specific location for too long. We wanted to make sure that we had the attitude of being flexible. So if we got down to ocean shores or some really nice resort that you really enjoy, that we weren't tied down where we couldn't make a change to our plans.
Yeah, because we really didn't. We don't always say 3 days here, 5 days here, whatever. Sometimes it was like, we'll go here and see how we feel.
Right. And we could end up being there for 2 days or we could be there for 2 weeks.
Yeah, like Vegas, that was spontaneous. We just went there and we had reservations just for a week, but the week was going so fast, and because, you know, you have normal life and then there's playing. And before you know it, the week was almost over and we decided we need another week here. So, and we had to pay for that place. So it wasn't a cheap place. It wasn't a cheap decision either. And stayed an extra week and went in and negotiated another week at a different space in a very busy park. But we didn't, that was spontaneous.
Right.
So when we're traveling, I know a lot of people use a lot of apps and stuff, but you and I tend to use only two things. What's that?
Google Maps.
Yep.
Is probably one of my favorites.
Yeah.
And the other one is?
We have a Magellan GPS.
Yep.
With that we bought from Camping World that has also has the Good Sam directory built into it. And so between those two, when we're driving, those are really the only two main apps. Do you ever jump over to any other maps?
If I'm looking for a specific thing, I might use another app that is more geared towards finding a Walmart or something like that. There's multiple, tons and tons of them out there. You could get overwhelmed if you try to keep up with all of them. So I stick with my favorite one as Google Maps, and then we'll switch over to something else if I'm looking for something specific.
Yeah. Plus, we always make it a habit when we're traveling to talk to people, and sometimes they'll kind of give us ideas like, you really need to go visit. If you like this, then you'll like that.
Right.
And sometimes we've been spontaneous of saying, let's go check that out, and we'll actually change our direction right then and there.
But on the cautionary side, though, that we found as we were going down south, and you're hitting in the peak season of the snowbirds, is when you're in peak season, a lot of the RV parks are full.
Yeah.
And so you cannot be real spontaneous.
Yeah. We tried to get in 1,000 Trails at Cottonwood in Arizona, and that's near Sedona. And we're members, and we couldn't get in.
Yeah. And we were trying to, schedule it out a couple weeks in advance, and they were booked up solid for months.
Yeah.
So when you get into some of the populated areas or real snowbird areas and stuff, really watch your peak seasons. And those areas you do need to plan in advance.
Definitely. And we're talking months, if not a half a year in advance, is what I'm understanding. So if you're heading towards snowbird areas and it's like from November till April, I would say, you need to try to get in those, put your reservations in.
Right.
And that's terrible for us because we're spontaneous. We hate to make reservations out 6 months because we never know if we're going to change our plans.
Well, you can still be spontaneous, but your options get limited.
Yep.
And you just, as long as you're willing to just kind of go with the flow and stuff, it's fine. But if you're really set on something, you do need to plan in advance.
Yep, definitely. All right, we're going to keep these questions moving here. So the next question we're going to take on is, do you ever have loud, rude, or other problem neighbors in the RV park, and how do you handle these situations? And we've been actually pretty fortunate. I don't think we've really had, if anything, we've had over-friendly neighbors more than rude ones. I think... In fact, that's been most recently. We've had one that was a little bit, on the odd side, but very friendly. And I don't know, probably didn't understand our schedule because, we meet a lot of older folks that You know, we tell them we're from RV Travel Buddy and RV Talk Radio, and I'll be in my RV all day recording or editing, and I'm not outside being kind of a yakker. And I imagine that some of the folks would probably think I'm unsociable a little bit. I hide in the RV or something, and I don't mean to, but this is my workplace. And so I know when, I don't know, many times we meet older RVers that don't comprehend. I always said like 95% of RVers do not document what they do. They don't watch the videos. They don't watch the channel. They have no idea who any of these people are, including RV Travel Buddy or RV Talk Radio. So they don't always relate to what we have to do every day, at least what I have to do, as far as this is my job now. So have we had any, can you think of any really bad neighbors we've had?
No, I don't think we've ever had any bad neighbors. I've heard stories from other people.
Yeah.
And typically in those cases, when they've had a confrontation, they have gone and reported it up at the front office and let the resort management handle the situation.
Yeah, I think the worst thing we've ever had is maybe we've gone to an RV park that had a lot of kind of partiers. Like we had some in Washington where on 4th of July weekends or something, they could be a little louder than normal.
But you got to be, you know,
flexible, yeah.
I'm kind of okay with that as long as it's not over the top, because everybody, we do live close quarters with other people, and people have a right to enjoy life and laugh and stuff like that. And as long as it's not over the top, you know, I'm fine with it.
Yeah. I think that's the worst scenario we've ever had, is maybe just louder campers than others. But we've never had, like, been right next to a party RV.
No.
So I imagine the time's coming and there will be something that will come up. But I would generally handle it through the manager. And I would probably elect first to move my own rig instead of having a confrontation, just because people are just out there sometimes. So it's better to be a little passive and try to find a solution without a confrontation, because, you know, we tend to be calm, but I've met people that they just lose it. And so I would be cautious and talk to the manager and find a calm solution to fixing the problem. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah.
So, all right. Well, that's how we'd answer that one. Sorry, we just don't have any really good stories on that one. So moving on to another question, since we really didn't have much for that last one, and we're probably not going to have much for this next one either, but I'm glad they're being asked because it kind of tells you more about me and Sherry, is have we ever been to an RV rally, like the Montana's owner group or anything like that? Or what sorts of things are there that are different between being at a regular RV park and a rally? And the question is, oh, the answer is to from us, we have no idea. We're not really groupies very well. I mean, we're not real good followers, I guess.
Well, they sound fun, but we've just never had the time or opportunity where we've gone to one, so can't really answer that question.
Yeah. We're members of Escapees and Good Sam stuff, and we've been to RV parks that have had like potlucks and stuff. Those are fun. We enjoy those. We don't always participate in making something for the potluck, but we're always happy to donate. But Sherry and I, once again, we're kind of real spontaneous. And I find, you know, it's like, for example, I've been trying to get to a hangout that someone does on Mondays at 4 o'clock. And you think I could ever get to that hangout? It's just, I want to. I love to. I think it'd be fun. But we get hung up on, we get sidetracked, or we're out and about on a road trip. And, but when we do anything that is group-wise, we enjoy it, kind of.
We enjoy it. We've done potlucks before, and yeah, they've been fun. We've It's a great place to meet people, so I would think that it could be very enjoyable if you like that type of social setting.
Yeah. Why would you think that? Why don't we do that more? I never really thought about it.
Normally it's because we got something else going on, or it's too far out in advance for us to plan that far in advance for our lifestyle.
Yeah. That's the hardest part, is probably, especially if it's like, in 3 months is a big rally, such and such. I have no idea what 3 months is going to look like. It could look, with us, it could look totally different than it does today. So we're always, we'll try our best to go. And it, a lot of times we don't make it. And I hate to tell people we're going to go, because then they look down on us or are disappointed. And we don't try to disappoint anybody. It's just our lifestyle. I guess we're in kind of a transitional mode. So we don't exactly know what everything's going to look like this year. And I also try to go to a rally or something like that. Be a little difficult right now, but we're certainly not opposed to them.
No.
So our next question is actually a pretty good one too. And I think our answers are going to be so different than a lot of folks. But here's one is like, how often do you thoroughly clean the outside of your RV? And is there really a major pain in the neck? Any tips on things you've learned over the years? And the answer is, hire someone to do it. I don't know, what do you think?
Well, if you can hire someone to do it, that's an easy way to do it. If you can't, there's definitely things you can do. Probably the hardest thing to clean on the outside would be the front of the rig where the bugs get splattered on it.
Yeah, I think bugs were really bad, if anything, I'd clean the front end off a lot. Now, remember the motorhome? That was a constant battle.
Yes.
We were always cleaning the front half of the front of the RV because of just the bugs, and the windshield would just get demolished with bugs. So I remember we'd have to do that a lot. But in the fifth wheel, basically when it gets to a point, like we're in Arizona, we hired some folks to come in and do it, and they're so efficient, and they do a really good job. And the average cost, I would say, around $100 plus or minus. And then if you want a wax job and stuff, it can grow from there. But it's all different. We're in Pioneer Trails, was it?
Mm-hmm.
Pablo, was that his name? Something like that. He was a really nice guy. And he'd only charge like $80 to wash your rig down. He really did a good job. And we'd always give him $100 anyway. But as far as that, I think we spend more detail in the inside than we do the outside. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah. There are definitely things you want to maintain, though. Is you definitely will, to keep the finish, you definitely need to wax it. You need to do the roof cleaning and protect it with the UV protectant stuff on it, and your tires.
Yeah. In fact, today we're actually doing a video that we're going to put the covers on our tires, and we're now contemplating putting UV protectant on the roof because we're in sunshine a lot, and we're going to decide whether we're going to do it ourselves or have some guy come in and put it on for us. Getting older and overweight doesn't help. Getting up on a roof is not the most top thing on our list to do. We do it if we have to. For maintenance and stuff, we've also had to make sure, we've had a little trouble with our slides a little bit, so we've been up there resealing things and taping. But as far as cleaning, I guess you have to kind of clean the areas that we're doing, and then
right.
Yeah, we did that. Inside, I think, has been the biggest shocker for you and I. One is the first battle we had was moisture, especially in the Washington area.
Yes, we had moisture, so we got a small dehumidifier, and that definitely helped. The inside, as far as the cleaning goes, the biggest thing I can say on that is you're in a small, tight space, so your cleaning and picking up is a constant chore that you're doing continuously, never ending.
And I think it kind of goes along with some of the things I've been talking about with critters. If you're, I visited somebody's RV just a couple days ago, and I noticed that their counters looked terrible. They didn't clean them a lot, and he was a single guy, so, you know, he was probably living that way. But those are ideal conditions for, like, sugar ants and things like that and little critters that can get in your rig, and it's more incentive for critters to want to get in. So I think you and I both have found that if I spill a little bit of sugar on the counter, is wipe it up quick. Don't leave that stuff out, because one is it's just good to always be cleaning, but two, critter control is another thing. Is if you spilt sugar on the floor or something, you better clean your floor good. Spill juice or something like that, you're looking for trouble.
Right.
And so, yeah, the other thing I noticed I saw right away when we started full-timing was we put an air purifier in our rig because of dust and stuff like that, and dog hair and cat hair.
Yeah, you're going to get a lot more dust in an RV versus a home just because of the travel and the environments we live in. So dusting is always a thing that you're doing on the inside, your countertops, keeping them clean. Even just picking stuff up and putting it away properly. Those are the big things.
Yeah, I mean, Sherry is obviously much more detailed and oriented than I am. And she's big rule number one in our household is try to put things back as you use them. I'm still terrible at it, but she's getting me trained better and better each week.
We're still working on it.
Yeah. But, you know, we don't let clothes pile up.
No.
We don't have laundry laying on the floor.
I don't let my dishes go more than, you know, an hour or so.
Yeah, we try not to leave stuff in the sink. You know, the simplest little things like having a bowl of ice cream, even if we don't do your dishes at a time, don't just throw it in the sink and stuff. I always water it down, rinse it off. And it's just to keep critters out. If a sugar ant makes it into our rig and finds something sweet like a bowl of ice cream is on this rim of a bowl, then he's going to tell his friends, and then his friends are going to start coming in. And so I constantly think about what's laying in our sink if we're going to leave the dishes out for a half a day or something like that. Is everything rinsed off at least? But yeah, those are the big thing. And you're really good about making sure our floors are good, because we're always bringing in dirt and rocks.
Yep.
So anyway, hope that kind of answers your question of what we do on cleaning maintenance. It's an ongoing thing. I know a big thing that's really important to keep in a rig is Lysol wipes or Clorox wipes. Those are awesome.
I use them in the bathroom daily.
Yeah. So those are great to have to do your counters with, your toilet, anything you want to sanitize quickly. It makes it just easy.
Yeah.
Yep. So, all right. Next question. All right. So the next question, this one's, we're not sure how we're going to answer it. I can probably answer some of it a little better than Sherry, because I actually just retired. But what stories have you heard from people as they transition from full-time work into retirement in an RV? How do they fare when they are 1 month or 6 months or 1 year plus into retirement? Does the experience of having an RV make this more easy in the transition? So, I don't think the word, just because you're an RVer will make you satisfied as a retiree.
No.
So it really comes down to, now I have a father-in-law who's a busy guy, and he retired, 17 years ago?
No, longer than that.
Well, yeah. And his famous quote, and I'm actually already saying it, is, I don't know where I had time to work. But he's got tons of hobbies. He's a garage kind of woodworker, metal worker. He's always tinkering. He's just busy, makes flutes, and then he does flint napping. And he's just always got something going on or building something. Just busy. And me, I've got my internet stuff, and we're doing a radio show, and I got the videos, and I don't know where I had time to work. And I actually used to do full-time internet marketing before I went back to the aerospace company I finished up at. So I know how to be busy, and I sometimes have a hard time just sitting down. I always talk about being grateful and smelling the roses, or just living for the now, instead of what do I got to do next? Where do I got to go? Why do I have to entertain myself all the time? It's just to be able to sit back and just chill out. I'm not a book reader type thing person like you are.
Oh, I'm not much of one compared to a lot of people.
Yeah. So whether it's an RV or not, like Jay, well, your father, he's not really an RVer. They had an RV, but they did for weekend warrior stuff, but they didn't live in it. But was he satisfied being retired? Hell yeah.
Yeah, he was very, very satisfied with retirement. I would say the biggest comment I hear from people who are RVing that have retired is, I wish I would have done it sooner.
Yeah, that's...
And so everybody seems to find their own little niche that works for them, and everyone is going to be different.
Yeah.
So, but the biggest thing is, everyone seems to be pretty happy about making the transition, and just asking themselves is, why didn't we do this sooner?
Yeah. Like, we have a friend that I worked with before I left. He is ready. He's much older. I mean, not much older, but in the 61, 62 realm. And perfect time to retire. And he's afraid to, because he says, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't have any hobbies like you, Rob. I think I'd be bored and drive my wife crazy. And I think that's not true. I think they just can't comprehend that the new lifestyle if they've worked so long, but I guess that could be applicable. I guess there's people out there really don't feel like they have anything to bide their time. I find that a little sad sometimes, but at the same time, I understand it too.
I can understand it and stuff, but I think people have to realize when they do retire from working that there are doors that have always been closed to them.
Yeah.
That now are all of a sudden they're open. They can, do volunteer work, whether you're RVing or not, but there's all kinds of just local activities and clubs and stuff that people can get involved in. It just takes a little bit of changing your mindset and making the big leap and going out and taking that first step and signing up for something.
Yeah. I think the other factor could be it's going to be health, your health. I mean, that's going to really play a factor whether you'd be happy retiring or not. Any other people is like, well, I make, $5,000-$10,000 a month now. How am I going to live on $6,000 a month, because, between their Social Security and pension, if they have that, or 401ks, or even less than that? And I think the answer to that is there's never enough money. It never is. If I made more than I did now, I'd want more. And it's just, so that's why I chose to retire at 55. Should I have waited? Probably. Common sense says I should have waited 59. Real common sense means I should have worked till 62 or 63 when I'm eligible for Medicare and stuff. That's what they want you to do. Sherry's glaring at me like, why didn't you do that? I already feel healthier. I actually think I'm starting to lose weight now. I'm happier. And, I've got to still try to make money above what our pension is and stuff. We won't see Social Security for another 7 or 8 years, and hopefully it's still there. So we're not the ideal retirees, but and then we get our insurance from your work, where Sherry's working, and we don't know how long we'll do that. Then we got to look at the different things, options we have for whether we can live a different lifestyle and still have the health care that we want and still afford, because it's this new Obama stuff is like, oh my God. So anyway, I don't think you should try to answer the retirement question as making it applicable to RVing, whether RVing would make it nicer. But every RVer I've seen that's retired has said the common thing that you said, why didn't I do this sooner? So I think that pretty much wraps up that question. So for this week, that's the questions we're going to tackle. I'd like to urge everybody, wouldn't you? Sure, because I don't want to do this.
I didn't say that.
If you have more questions or have a set of questions you'd like us to address on the show, this was awesome. I want to thank Steve very much from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, for sending those questions to us. He did it privately, and we really appreciate it. He left a phone number. If I may call him up and say, give me some more questions. That was really good. It was really nice to have you on the show, Cher. Mm-hmm. She goes, all right, let's go play now. This is like work. Anyway, so we want to thank you. I want to thank Sherry for being on the show. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anyway, so I'm going to let her go and then finish off the show. So once again, if you have more questions, send them on in. You can contact us through the website at rvtalkradio.com to the contact page, or just send them directly to me at rob@rvtalkradio.com and send us your questions that we can address in future shows. Thanks. Well, we're getting down to the end of the show here, and I want to thank once again Sherry for being on the show, and want to remind you folks that we really do like your comments. And I know I keep saying that, and I just want, and some people are doing it, and it's really adding more to the show. So please take the time to ask us questions and leave comments, and it just stimulates us for all kinds of good stuff. In the future, what we got going on is Sherry and I have been contemplating getting to some of the cactus museums. We want to learn the flowers and the different cactus flowers and different kind of cactuses a little bit down here a little bit. So you can tell in our videos, we just don't know the names of anything out down here. And the critters too. We're just loving the birds. We're trying to get some, we're getting some really good shots of hummingbirds, but we'd love to get more shots of, like, we love these little roadrunners. And then I get to some other real beautiful birds, and we just got to figure out how we're going to get pictures of them. So we'll pull it off. And we're fascinated by the snakes and all that stuff. As long as we see them before they see us, we're happy. So lots of things. There's so much to do in Arizona. We want to go see some mines. We want to go check out the different plants and different kinds of regions and some of the history, the gold mining stuff, water sports that some of the people do here. The other thing I would love to see, or maybe even rent, is learn a little bit about, a lot of people are really into sand buggies, or what they call rails here, or quads, to enjoy the sand dunes and things like that. And that's a common thing here. So racing's a big thing going on. So our list of things to do in Arizona is going to keep us very busy while we're here. And then now that we're closer to the border, we're also maybe looking at adventures over the border, whether it's cruising, whether it's flying to someplace, different kinds of adventures that Sherry and I haven't considered before, because now we're static, we can consider some other kinds of adventures we've never done before. Or going over to the California coast and maybe doing some deep sea fishing, things like that. That we, now we're here, we're going, well, gosh, we're residents here now, in a sense. Let's go enjoy some of the things the residents would do, and which are completely new to us, but in the Northwest, we're unheard of. So, busy, busy stuff going on, lots of adventures. We're just trying to prioritize all these different things we want to do. In the meantime, I want to remind you that we also have the new Daydream Explorer channel. And also check this out, people.com. That's products. A lot of them are going to be RV-related products, but they'll be like cameras, electronics, things like that. And we thought it would be nice to have a platform that just specialized in products and services and that we could tell you about that we enjoyed. And then Daydream Explorer will be not only a little bit of RVing in it, but the things that branch out that aren't exactly RV-related, but are just really fun to share. So I think if you're an RV already, I think you'll enjoy Daydream Explorer. And there's a website. It's still being developed, but it's there. We already have a channel. The best thing to do on YouTube is just go over there and subscribe to it. And I think I'm actually working on a production on one of our first videos where I actually want to take all the gorgeous pictures we've gotten of cactuses and flowers and stuff like that and actually put a longer show together that just makes you feel good about the gorgeous stuff here in the desert. So with that in mind, lots of things going on. I want to thank you very much for listening to us. I'm really thankful Sherry's on the show. And I want to urge you once again to not hesitate to comment and send us your questions. Give us your feedback and be grateful for what we have already and be grateful for things that are going to come your way. So I'm Rob Scribner from RV Talk Radio. Thanks for listening. See you next Monday. Bye now.